Okay, let's break down this Dateline NBC episode. Hey guys, this is Jules with True Crime Reactions. If you have not gotten the chance to watch the Dateline NBC episode on the Idaho 4 case that released last night, if you go to their website, nbc.com/dateline, and you sign up using your email, they give you 3 credits. That gives you access to watch 3 full-length episodes to any show that you want to, for completely free. Now, one thing I do want to mention off the bat is the timing of the release of this episode. I find it really interesting that within a few days of this secret grand jury situation, they released this with these sources and all this gag order stuff going on, and Dateline has these sources, and I just find it interesting, the timing of this release, and I'm just going to leave that there. If any of the information that they gave us in this episode ends up being legitimate, then it could actually answer some questions on the trash DNA, the sheath DNA, the whole genealogical crap that we've been talking about. I think I kind of have it figured out the way that they did this. Anything in the PCA that talks about the DNA from the Pennsylvania trash cans and the sheath, it talks about December 27th getting the trash from the trash can in Pennsylvania, and then it being sent to the Idaho State Lab, and that's whenever they found out that the trash can DNA was 99.9% most likely the father of the suspect. So I was going through the way that they were chronologically ordering things, and the way that they made it sound is that on the 12:15 double traffic stops that we've all seen body cam footage, they're telling us that the original reports of the FBI orchestrating those stops is completely false, and that instead these cops that ended up pulling Brian Koberger and his father over twice, they were doing some sort of like drug trafficking watch type situation, watching for erratic driving behaviors. So it kind of makes you wonder what kind of driver he really is. And then again, if you consider the fact that he had been pulled over in Pullman in October and then in Moscow in August, legitimately, Brian Koberger may just be a really crappy driver, because if the FBI really had nothing to do with that, yeah, he must just be like a crap driver. That's the only thing I can really get from that. But with what they're telling us, during the time of those traffic stops, they still did not have Brian Koberger on their radar, which I find interesting considering the fact that the PCA mentions that the security or the police officers over at WSU pulled the database to show which Hyundai Elantras from that date range they actually had in the database. And then about a half hour or so later, a whole other cop ends up seeing the white Hyundai Elantra in Brian Koberger's apartment building parking lot. And that's not mentioned in the Dateline NBC episode whatsoever. So even though it seems as if the police could have definitely had Brian Koberger's information as soon as November 29th, it seems as if they really didn't have any clue who they were looking for until after those double traffic stops. Because it sounds like this is what happened. It wasn't until after December the 16th that they sent for the genealogical testing. Now, they didn't mention where the testing was done, but we have heard rumors about the Othram Labs in Woodlands, Texas, which is right outside of Houston, being involved in this part. Now, it states here that whenever they sent it over there, they pulled the touch DNA profile, and they told the cops they needed to look at a very specific family tree. And apparently the list of people on this family tree was so small that they had a very specific name. Now, the name on this list is probably who the real informant is that's being protected. I've learned a lot more about genealogical informant since I posted the video about that weird verbiage in the ICR rules. And honestly, it makes more sense. I don't understand why things have to be worded the way that they're worded. It's kind of unfair, really, if you think about it, because I'm no fool, okay? I work in the medical field. I feel like I'm pretty intelligent. I have a degree in criminal forensic science, but even I wasn't aware that there could be a genealogical informant that can be protected that isn't an actual snitch type informant. I wasn't aware of that. I don't really know a lot of ways that the court proceedings go. I've never been arrested. I've gotten one speeding ticket my entire life. I don't really know a lot about the way the court processes work. But this scenario would make that make sense. So it seems like after December the 16th is whenever they found this person's name as a very close immediate family member match to the suspect. After they received the genealogical shortlist with this immediate family member's name on it, that they then went and got the GPS coordinate tracking information for Brian Koberger's phone. So in actuality, even though the PCA, like I've mentioned, shows that there was viable proof that they had tips on Brian Koberger and the white Hyundai Elantra as early as 11:29, they did not actually even have Brian Koberger on their radar whatsoever until after December the 16th. And I did go back through the PCA information and look at the search warrants. It does show that there was a warrant for just the towers themselves in the area back in November. But on 12/23 is whenever Detective Payne put the information in to get Brian Koberger's direct AT&T information. So those dates do line up. So with them now giving us that information, even though it's coming from unknown sources and we have this gag order, and I know there's a lot of people saying how, like, this is really strange that even now that the gag order is still in place currently and we have motions for the family's gag order and the media's gag order stuff happening Monday, that they released all of this information right now. And it's true. It is interesting that with as hardcore as they're going on this gag order, that Dateline NBC decided to go ahead and put this information out there and still not name a single source. So it's almost curious how many people are going to end up really being in trouble after all this is done and over with. Now, while we're still talking about family, before we get into this next part, I do want to mention ahead of time that Dateline NBC did state after the fact, and I'm going to give this to you beforehand, that whenever they reached out to the lawyer that is in contact with Brian Koberger's family for a response or a statement on this information, they didn't receive one. So it's interesting that they still put this out in their episode, especially right now. Remember, I find it very interesting the timing of this episode's release to what happened with the grand jury. According to Dateline, sources are telling them that one of Brian Koberger's sisters, who was at their parents' house in Pennsylvania at the time of Brian Koberger's arrest, whenever he was there apparently just visiting over winter break, that she brought up very loudly and in front of everyone in the house how Brian not only lived very close to where these things happened, but that he also had a vehicle that fit the description, and that she found it really odd that all of a sudden he was wearing latex gloves literally everywhere, including his parents' house. And apparently, more than one family member went outside and started searching Brian Koberger's white Hyundai Elantra for any sort of evidence that they might find to prove their suspicions correct. Now, it is interesting that the car keeps being mentioned in this, but we haven't really heard much about what was found in it. The evidence list that we did receive didn't really allude to there being any biological evidence found. I don't know why they would do a separate list for what could be released to the public and what couldn't, especially since they have him in jail. If they're so sure, then I don't understand why we're not getting more information on the Elantra itself. I know that the police have mentioned several times that whenever they were watching him in Pennsylvania that he did clean the Hyundai Elantra, but I will reiterate something that I have mentioned several times on my channel. Every time you see him in body cam footage, the double stops, and also whenever he was pulled over in Pullman back in October, the dashboard of his vehicle is immaculately spotless. So for him to want to take his vehicle to a car wash and get it cleaned, after we saw how dirty the outside of it was on that 2,500 mile road trip, it's not shocking that he would want to do so. Now, something that Dateline mentioned this time that I literally have not heard anywhere else is the fact that he used bleach while cleaning his car. anyone else heard that before? Because I honestly don't recall it. Now for the ID cards. Do you guys remember how there was like breaking news that was supposed to come out with Chris Cuomo on News Nation? And then they pushed it back and they didn't release it. And Jennifer Coffendaffer was all up on Twitter talking about how she was going to be on Chris Cuomo and to be watching for the information because, oh, they just had a bombshell and then nothing. And then they came out like the next day and was like, well, this is what we had to tell you, but for some reason we were told not to tell you when we wanted to tell you, but now we're telling you. And at that point, and correct me if I'm wrong, because I'm pretty positive that's exactly the way the situation went. Then whenever they finally came out, Chris Cuomo and Ms. Coffendaffer were talking about the fact that they were trying to state that there was one of the victim's IDs in the glove that was inside of a box inside of the parents' house. Now, it's interesting that Jennifer Coffendaffer is now on Dateline, with Dateline telling us that these IDs did not belong to any of the victims, that there was two women's IDs in there that had nothing to do with King Road, and here she is giving commentary on it again. So which one was it, Mrs. Coffendaffer? Was it a victim's ID from King Road, or was it not? And why are you giving commentary on both sides of the story? Pick one and stick to it, please. Something else mentioned in here that I found extremely interesting was that instead of going the route that News Nation and so many other media sources are going, trying to claim that Brian Koberger was stalking the victims on social media, that he had messaged some of the victims several times and been left on read and hadn't been responded to and all these things, whoever Dateline NBC is talking to states that all of that is false. So again, is he a super stalker who stalked his prey and followed them on social media and was an incel because he wasn't getting their attention, or was he not? It's really interesting to me that Dateline even put that in their episode because they really pointed to the whole incel thing pretty much the entire time. So for them to then come out and say, well, our source says he wasn't stalking them, that's like a contradiction, is it not? I'm honestly a little confused on why they even put that in there, since it goes against, honestly, the episode's entire narrative. Another thing I found extremely interesting is they're trying to state that they've been given proof that Brian Koberger ordered the K-Bar knife on Amazon all the way back in, like, April, before he even moved to Pullman, Washington. And look, I know that there's a lot of things in this case that just seem really super careless and make no sense, right? And for someone who spent a decade in criminal justice, I highly doubt he was going to just buy his murder weapon on a completely traceable website like Amazon. And if he did it months prior, that's even a little stranger to me, because he could have struck at any moment and any time, and there's still no viable connections to King Road whatsoever. So honestly, this whole thing about him having the knife back in April and blah, 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 we'll see what court says when it comes to the rest of this information and maybe the search warrant results being released, but that just doesn't seem logical, honestly. They keep going back to those, like, over a dozen pings of his GPS showing him being in the area. I do want to state something. This is a neighborhood where these kids will party pretty much, like, every night to a certain point, and then just make sure that they have basically conditioned themselves to be able to get up the next morning to go and do what they're supposed to do. Now, with all these late night situations that they're trying to state that Brian Koberger was in the area a dozen times prior, there's not a single person in that neighborhood that states they recognize his face or his car. So for him to have been over there 12 times in just a matter of months, whenever these kids are up all night, they're walking around their little area constantly and no one recognizes him, that's still just interesting. They did bring up Papa Roger, and according to Dateline, investigators are fully in belief that the original Papa Rogers on the internet was Brian Koberger. And they're basing that off the fact that the Papa Rogers account mentioned the knife sheath before the PCA was released and the rest of the world knew about the knife sheath. Now, there is a Papa Rogers account that gets on certain lives and in certain chats for Brian Koberger's case being discussed. And I've been given some information via email that this is not the original Papa Rogers. I will call it a troll account because they created an account with a name that has a lot of chaos connected to it, and the things that they post are not really anything case related. It's a bunch of metaphorical speaking, and at the end of the weird sentences it always says "sent from my iPad." It's a troll account, regardless of what anyone tries to actually say about it. And if the original Papa Rogers was Brian, I don't know, but if the investigators really think it was, then I expect them to show a paper trail of that come court. But that's it. That's really the only newish sort of information that I got from this Dateline episode. And again, none of their sources are being named. We are in the middle of an extremely doubled down, tripled down, quadrupled down freaking gag order. And they decided to release this information within days of the grand jury indictment and now within days of the arraignment coming Monday. If this isn't jury tainting, then I don't know what is, honestly. But they still released some kind of conflicting information. Like, is he an incel or is he not an incel? Was he stalking them or was he not stalking them? Did he have the girls' IDs or did he not have the girls' IDs? Mrs. Coffendaffer. I guess we're just going to have to really wait and see. I mean, there's still a lot to discuss here. But damn if the questions just don't keep building up. It really gives you, like, sort of an insight to how serious tips are actually taken if you think about it. Because like I mentioned, the PCA itself, the probable cause affidavit for Brian Koberger's arrest, mentions the fact that WSU found the car in the database on November 29th and also saw the car in Brian Koberger's apartment's parking lot. But then if they didn't do a damn thing about him being the number one suspect until the genealogical data came out, that's like 2.5 weeks after the 11/29. That's a long time that they still had no clue what was going on. And it's still interesting that the first reports about those double pullovers were all about how the FBI orchestrated that. And now it's all being completely denied. I wonder if the truth of that's gonna come out. It's already bad enough that they're trying to tell us there's literally zero body cam of his arrest, but they stalked him for basically like 2 weeks in Pennsylvania alone. So how there's no footage available of literally anything, they must just think that we're stupid. But like I said, that's it. I want to know what you guys got from this. Was there something that I missed? Did something get said that was new and interesting that I just maybe skipped over? Let me know in the comments, and I also would like to know if this new episode with this information has changed your mind at all about the way that you have been viewing this case. At this point, I just have more questions. I'm still not seeing a connection between Brian and the victims being given to us. It's not there. It's all circumstantial and no actual connecting. So I'm still waiting. But like I did mention in my community post, I am off on Monday and I'm going to do the best I can to update you guys on what's going on in real time. And if True Crime with Dago goes live, I will most likely jump on his channel that day. I'm sure he's going to be going over everything as well. But until then, see y'all.